Grace and peace to you, church, in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Welcome to worship with Amity Presbyterian Church. A warm welcome to anyone visiting with us today and to those who are worshiping online via our live stream. We are so very glad to gather with you as well. Just so you all know, in light of new updates about mask requirements and all of those things, the session has met and voted on how to proceed for worship. And what the session has decided is that during worship, we will remain masked. I won't while I'm up here, but if I'm out there, I will be, while we are worshiping together. And that is because we are not a fully vaccinated congregation. We are not. Simply not possible just yet. So while we are waiting, we will continue to wear masks in order to welcome everyone to worship. It's a matter of hospitality and welcome. We want everybody to feel comfortable here. But I do have good news. We will be singing together while masked and distanced throughout the congregation, as distanced as you can be. Gently sing with your mask. That's hard for some of us to gently sing, but keep that in mind. You are invited during the congregational songs to sing this week with your mask on, please. I also want to let you know that next Sunday we will gather here again and we will celebrate communion together. We will have the communion elements for you and they will be distributed in a COVID-safe way. But if you feel more comfortable, you are welcome to bring your own and let the Holy Spirit bless yours just like it will bless the ones that we provide, okay? So come and bring a friend and let's celebrate the Lord's Supper next Sunday. All right, church, we are here. We are gathered. So let's turn our hearts and minds to God in worship as the 11 o'clock hour is timed. We have gathered to worship. Church, as Easter people, thank you, Donna. As Easter people, we celebrate the Spirit that continues to give life and breath to our dry bones. The day of Pentecost has arrived and calls us to dance in the wind and the fire of the Spirit, to feel, to allow exuberance to fill our bodies and souls. With those in Jerusalem on that day, may we dare to dance as Easter people, as Pentecost people, as we celebrate the Spirit that continues to give life and breath. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place, and suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them.
Look, do you see her? Sacred Spirit that danced and breathed over the deep before the beginning of things. Restless breath of God that makes ordinary people into prophets and witnesses to the divine. holy flame that burns but does not consume, that refines, that inspires, that transforms. Do you see her? She danced through the ancient days. She danced among the disciples as they waited. She danced in the space above and around. She danced on their tongues, and they began to speak. They worshiped and proclaimed the wonders of God in every language, sacred flame. She danced, and the church was born. The church began to move and breathe. The fire of love, the body of Christ, born of the Spirit and bound together, creating the church. We are becoming the church. She is not done creating. We are not done becoming. Look. Do you see her? She dances still. We are not who we once were, and we are not who we shall be. Speak, holy flame. Dance, fire of love. Transform, sacred breath. Guide the steps of our becoming a church into life, an inheritance not of ashes, but of fire and light. Church and spirit wrapped in power and mystery, waiting, dancing. Come, Holy Spirit.
Beloved, the Spirit is here. God is here. Let us rise in body or spirit and lift our voices in song, singing, "O breathe on me, O breath of God," which is in the insert in your bulletin.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Friends, we come to the baptismal font remembering that in these waters, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we are called children of God. And so each week in our prayer of confession, we try to tell the truth about ourselves, about our lives, not because God doesn't know us, God does, but because so often we don't know ourselves. And we do it together because it reminds us that even in our brokenness, we are never alone. So let's pray first together with the prayer in your bulletin and then offer to God our prayers of confession in silence. Let us pray. Loving God, hear our prayer. For those times we stifle your spirit, O God. For those times we ignore your whispers and shouts. For those times when we turn away from your wonders and miracles. Forgive us. Let your spirit dance within our spirits, moving, uprooting, refreshing, and guiding. Hear now our silent prayers of confession. Amen. Siblings in Christ, God's Spirit did not leave us after that first Pentecost. The Spirit is still with us, empowering us to know God's grace and God's mercy and to transform us. So, like water, let it wash over you. Let it make you new today and every day. Let's speak together as we are led in the words of assurance found in your bulletin.
Assurance of grace.
Go ahead.
When our steps falter and we lose our rhythm,
we trust the Holy Spirit to lead and guide us.
When we make the same mistakes we've made before,
we trust that God is patient and kind.
Friends, receive the good news of the gospel.
In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and free. Alleluia. Amen. I'd like to invite any children here this morning. Come on, Louise and Davey, come on down. As we sing, Jesus Loves Me, together as a congregation. Come on down.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me.
Remember last week when we met outside and I told you the story, we all heard the story of how Jesus went back to heaven, Jesus ascended to heaven to be with God, and I said that Jesus was giving, going to send his people a gift, right? You think it's the Holy Spirit? You're right. It's the Holy Spirit. How did you know? You listened last week and it said, I will send the Holy Spirit. Good. I'm glad to know you were listening. That's good. Yes. So Jesus promised to send the gift of the Holy Spirit. And that is what we celebrate today. Do you remember the name of this Sunday? Pentecost. That's right. That's the big churchy word for the day that we celebrate the gift of the Holy Spirit. And so Scripture tells us that after Jesus went back to be with God, all his followers were in one place, and they were gathered, and they were worshiping, and they were sharing the good news of the gospel and telling everybody about Jesus, and more people were coming to believe when they heard the good news. And then, this is important, you ready? And then, on one day, all of a sudden, there was a sound like the rushing of a violent wind. A big, strong wind when all the people were gathered in one place. And then, this is crazy. Are you listening? This is wild, okay? There was a rushing wind. And then it looked like there were what's called tongues of fire. Not tongues like in your mouth. Tongues, that means like a flame. It looked like there were flames above, dancing above all the people's heads, dancing over their heads. So there was rushing wind. Flames over everybody's heads. And then something else really cool happened. All the people started speaking in all different languages, because these were people from all over the place. And they were all speaking in all different languages. And not just that, Davy, not just that. They could all understand what everybody else was saying, even though they were speaking languages they didn't know how to speak. Because the Holy Spirit did that. What if that happened in here? What do you think? It would be weird. Yeah, that would be crazy. That'd be wild. That'd be unexpected. But you never know. So look out, church. You never know what the Holy Spirit is going to do. Never know. But one thing we do know that the Holy Spirit does, that we can be sure of, is that when the Holy Spirit shows up, the Holy Spirit changes people. It changes our hearts, changes our lives, and it can change the world. It's really, really powerful. You thought we had to change ourselves? Well, sometimes we have to do work, yeah, when we learn how we need to change, for sure. But the good news about God is that God helps us. Sometimes God does work that we don't know how to do and helps us change ourselves and changes our hearts, okay? And that's how the world gets changed, when God's people listen to the Holy Spirit and let the Holy Spirit work. So I want to teach you guys a song that I learned when I was little. And church, you can do this with me. You probably know this one too. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. I remember singing this in Bible school and Sunday school and all sorts of things growing up. But it has motions. So that's what I want to make sure that we all learn. I'm going to stand up so that the grown-ups can see us too, okay? So the words are Spirit of the living God. We're going to do this. This is the sign for Spirit. Like you take your fingers. Yeah, you can do them out there. Spirit. Spirit of the living God. Then we're going to take our hand like this. Fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God. Fall afresh on me. And then the next part, this is about how we want the Holy Spirit to change us and help us be good. We're going to say, melt me. I'm going to do like this. That means change my shape. Melt me. Mold me. So yeah, melt me. Mold me. Fill me. I'm going to be filled up with the Holy Spirit. And the last one is use me. We want the Holy Spirit to send us out to do God's work. And so that, take your hand like this under your elbow and two fingers. Use me. Okay? So let's do it one more time. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. We're saying that twice. And then melt me, mold me, fill me, use me. That one's hard to remember, okay? All right, so let's sing it. And if you know it, you can sing it, or you can just try to do the motions. You ready? So it starts with Spirit. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Let's sing that again. Spirit. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Melt me. Melt me. Mold me. Fill me. Use me. Spirit. That was our prayer for today. That song is a prayer, asking the Spirit to be with us, to change us, to help us be good, okay? So you guys can go back to your seat. Thank you for joining me up here. All right.
The New Testament reading this morning is taken from Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 21. If you'd like to follow along, it's on page 1691 in your pew Bible. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard the sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment, because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygian and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we heard them declaring the wonders of God in their own tongues. Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, what does this mean? Some, however, made fun of them and said they have had too much wine. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd. Fellow Jews and all you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These people are not drunk as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God said, I will pour out of my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will turn to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved."
You've heard Pentecost story. The story of how wild and unpredictable action of the Holy Spirit birthed the church. But now let's turn back to the Old Testament, where the prophet Ezekiel brings us along on an experience that he had with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit that didn't just show up for the first time on Pentecost, but that has been moving and creating since the beginning of things. So listen once again for God's word for us today from Ezekiel 37, verses 1 through 14. The hand of the Lord was on me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, "Son of man, can these bones live?" I said, "Sovereign Lord, you alone know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, 'Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord.' This is what the Sovereign Lord says to these bones: I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord." So I prophesied as I was commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together. Bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, "Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, 'This is what the Sovereign Lord says: Come, breath, from the four winds, and breathe into these slain, that they may live.'" So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them. They came to life, and they stood up on their feet, a vast army. Then he said to me, "Son of man, these bones are the people of Israel. They say, 'Our bones are dried up, and our hope is gone. We are cut off.' Therefore, prophesy and say to them, 'This is what the Sovereign Lord says: My people, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord. When I open your graves and bring you up from them, I will put my spirit in you and you will live. I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken and I have done it, declares the Lord." This is the word of God, and it is for you, the people of God. Today on this Pentecost Sunday, the lectionary gives us two incredibly visceral passages of Scripture. These aren't the complex theological and doctrinal missives of, say, the Apostle Paul. These texts, these are word paintings. Word paintings of moments where the earthiness of human existence intermingles with the wildness of the supernatural in this chaotic divine dance. In the Pentecost story that Ken read so well, there's rushing wind. There's rushing wind and tongues of fire. There's all these people using their very human mouths to speak all their very human languages. But something has changed. Where just moments before, their different languages kept them divided, now they can understand one another. This shouldn't be possible, but somehow, with wind and fire and spirit, it is. What was once predictable and manageable has been thrown into holy chaos, and the gospel is proclaimed like never before. In the Ezekiel passage, we have bones. Not just a few, we have a valley full of dead, dry bones. And then the text speaks of tendons and flesh, of muscle and skin. Bones rattle and breath fills bodies. Then they come to life and they rise. This is about as earthy and human a story that there can be. And yet, it's not, is it? The Holy Spirit arrives, and a mere human prophesies, and what was dead comes alive. And there it is again, church, that earthiness of human existence intermingling with the wild unruliness of the Holy Spirit in this divine dance. Do you know what that means, church? Do you know what happens when the Holy Spirit dances through our very human lives? What happens is that we, who were once just people, we become the people of God. We become people with a story that ties us to something beyond our own human lives, that ties us to each other in a particular way. We who were once just people become the people of God, whether we understand how or what has happened or not. So let's look deeper at this valley of dry bones, shall we? You see, Ezekiel was a prophet to Israel in exile. Judah had been destroyed, and the people had been scattered after the Babylonian destruction in 586 BCE. Their land was no longer their own. Their cities had been laid to waste. As a people, they were lost. They were isolated. They were hopeless. They were utterly defeated. Devastation and death had come to their doorstep, and it had named them and claimed them. When the Lord brought the prophet Ezekiel to this valley and walked him back and forth through the dead, dry bones, he was bringing the prophet face to face with the state of his own people. Something he already knew, but maybe couldn't bear to see it all at once. Church, how much and how often over this last year or so have we been brought face to face with the same? How often have we had to look at our own brokenness as individuals, as communities of faith, as people of particular cultural identities, as a nation, as global citizens? We have come face to face with our own mortality and our own sin. This pandemic season has utterly shattered our illusions of control, and it brought deep brokenness to the surface. It's brought real death and grief, isolation and exile. It's been this ongoing invitation to a reckoning. We've been invited, like Ezekiel, to see the state of our own people. With Ezekiel, we have been brought to the valley of our own dry bones, and the sight of it is overwhelming. But listen, church. Listen to what God does after showing Ezekiel this valley of bones, this valley of death and brokenness. God doesn't just bring him there and rub his nose in what's become of his people. He doesn't shame him or leave him to weep among the dead and the devastation. No. God asks him a simple question. He asks, Ezekiel, can these bones live? And Ezekiel, weary and discouraged, but so faithful, says the only thing that he can say for sure in answer to that question, he says, God, only you know that. Only God knows. And of course, God does know. God tells the prophet to do what prophets do, prophesy. He tells him to speak the word of the Lord, to speak life into these dead, dry bones. And he does. He speaks, and the bones begin to rattle. Tendons and muscles grow, flesh and skin form and take shape. Bones become bodies. And it's interesting that God doesn't just have Ezekiel wave a magic wand and poof, the bones become living, breathing people. There's a process to it. Steps and stages in a particular order that moves them from death to life. Healing is like that. Resurrection is like that. It takes time, and you can't skip a step or it throws off the whole process. So Ezekiel is prophesying as God told him to do, and the bones have become bodies. But he says, there is no breath in them. Now the Hebrew word for breath is ruach. And it's the same word used elsewhere in this passage and elsewhere in Scripture for life or spirit. The bones had become real human bodies, but there was no ruach, no life, no spirit in them. And it's only when God tells the prophet to speak to the ruach, and Ezekiel does so, that the spirit breath blows from the four winds and the bodies live and stand and move and breathe. There's that divine dance again. God invites and the prophet participates. Ezekiel calls to the spirits. The spirit enters the people and they come to life. No longer are they dead, dry bones. No longer does their story end with death and desolation. Now they are God's living people, restored to life by the ruach, the breath of life, the spirit of God. And church, this is important. They were restored together. This resurrection, like the one that comes through Christ, it is a collective resurrection. Every dead, dry pile of bones in that valley is restored. God doesn't command Ezekiel to just resurrect the heroes or the good ones, the ones with the few enough strikes on their life. was all of them. They are no longer just a collection of old bones. They are God's people who live and move in their very human bodies with the breath of the holy in their lungs, whose very existence is a witness to the wild and the miraculous, untamable presence of the Holy Spirit. Friends, the same was true for those early Christians on that Pentecost day, and the same is true for us today. On that day, the arrival of the Holy Spirit removed barriers and limitations. She took a bunch of people who spoke different languages, came from different places, and she opened their ears and transformed them into a collective witness to the gospel of Jesus Christ. That is what the Holy Spirit does. She transforms. She makes a way out of no way. She breathes life into what seems dead and broken. She turns ordinary people with all their broken bones and wounded places. She turns them into prophets and witnesses to God's redeeming power. And she does it in churches, too. Ordinary churches, like this one, made up of ordinary people like us, with all our faults, with all our missteps, with all our gifts and hopes. The Holy Spirit transforms us into living witnesses to the good news of Jesus Christ. So, church, when you find yourself in a valley of dry bones, maybe they are your own. But when you find yourself there and someone asks, can these bones live? I want to challenge you to give a different answer than Ezekiel did. When faced with the question, can new life come from this, resist the urge to say, only God knows. Because we are a Pentecost people. We can say with the foolish confidence of people who have danced with the divine, we can say instead, come, Holy Spirit. We can look at what is broken and say, come, Holy Spirit, and tend to these wounds. Come, Holy Spirit, and grow tendons and muscle and flesh on those dead places that seem to have lost their humanity. We can look at what is lifeless and say, come, Holy Spirit, and breathe life. Come and help us rise and dance again. We can prophesy like Ezekiel did to dry bones and dead hearts and say, come, Holy Spirit. We can cry out to a world that is languishing in a valley of its own death and say to it, come alive. Come alive. There is grace here. There is hope here. There is love and belonging and transformation here. God is here, and God is calling you to come alive. So I ask the question once again. Our Pentecost question today. Church, can these bones live? Alleluia. Amen.
Through the eyes of men, it seems there's so much we have lost. As we look down the road where all the prodigals have walked, and one by one the enemy has whispered lies and led them off as slaves. But we know that you are God, yours is the victory. We know there is more to come that we may not yet see. So with the faith you've given us, we'll step into the valley unafraid. As we call out to dry bones, come alive, come alive. We call out to dead hearts, come alive, come alive. Up out of the ashes, let us see an army rise. As we call out to dry bones, come alive. God of endless mercy, God of unrelenting love, rescue every daughter, bring us back the wayward sons. By your Spirit, breathe upon them, show the world that you alone can save. You alone can save. As we call out to dry bones, come alive, come alive. We call out to dead hearts, come alive, come alive. Up out of the ashes, let us see an army rise. We call out to dry bones, come alive. So breathe, O breath of God. Breathe, O breath of God. Breathe, O breath of God. Now breathe. Breathe, O breath of God. Breathe, O breath of God. Breathe, O breath of God. Now breathe. As we call out to dry bones, come alive, come alive. We call out to dead hearts, come alive, come alive. Up out of the ashes, let us see an army rise. We call out to dry bones, come alive. We call out to dry bones, come alive.
Friends, we are invited by the Holy Spirit to come alive in that dance of the divine. And one way we enter into that dance is through prayer. We pray with and we pray for one another. So I want to invite you now, through words and through music, to enter in to prayer, trusting God to meet us and transform us. Let us pray. Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, and fill us with your love. Open our eyes to see the presence of the sacred all around us. And in the stillness of this sacred space, in the busyness and the noise of our city streets, in the joys and the celebrations of our lives, in the tragedies and the struggles that break our hearts. Come, Holy Spirit, and comfort those who grieve. Grant them the peace that only you can bring. Stir within us a trust in life beyond death, as we ponder the mysteries of Christ's resurrection and the hope that we have in a new and everlasting life. Come, Holy Spirit. Come and bring wholeness to the sick. Strengthen those who are weak. Heal the wounded and the broken. Give rest to the weary. Come, Holy Spirit, and inspire our warring world to seek peace, to love our enemies, to put away our weapons, to remember the great cost of our endless conflict.
Teach me to pray with the power of Easter, following Christ in a life resurrected. Teach me to act with compassion and justice. Teach me to dance with the beat of your heart.
Come, Holy Spirit, and ignite a fire in our bones, a passion for justice that cannot be quenched until all of your children are loved, until no one is marginalized or oppressed, until everyone has the opportunity to thrive, and until the world is transformed and renewed. Come, Holy Spirit, and revive your church. Liberate us from complacency and apathy, and inspire us with Christ's vision for a world reborn. Help us to recognize our gifts for ministry and to use them in service to others. Transform our hearts and our minds, Lord. Fill us with love that overflows. Remind us that there is no greater calling than to love you with all that we are and to love our neighbors as ourselves. Gracious God, give us a glimpse of your kingdom emerging around us and drawing us into the new things you are doing in the world. It is for your kingdom that we now pray, filled with your Spirit, using the words that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Church, you are invited to rise in body or spirit as we sing together hymn number 129, Come, O Spirit, dwell among us. It's in your hymnal.
Thank you.
Church, we know that proclaiming resurrection and daring to dance with the Holy Spirit doesn't always mean that everything is okay. But it does bring us the energy that we need if we are to continue to dance the dance of justice and find the steps of service. So when we give of our resources to God's mission, we put life in dry bones and shoes on dancing feet to continue God's work in the world. We will not be passing the offering plate during the service today, but you will find it at the back of the sanctuary as you leave, or you can give online through our website. But we give thanks to God for your faithful gifts and for God's good plans for them. So now, church, receive this benediction. Go out into the world and labor to bring forth new life. Dream dreams, pursue visions, and speak of God's goodness in the words of those who would hear. And may the God who breathed life into creation be your delight too. May Christ Jesus give you hope for your dreaming. And may the Holy Spirit, your advocate and your supporter, set your hearts ablaze with passion. This day and every day, church, come alive. And all God's people said, amen. Let's sing amen. 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 One more time, church. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.